Good morning, everybody. How are we doing? Very well? Awesome. Sweet. Well, let's go ahead and stand up. And let's seek the Lord this morning. Oh, Father God, you are just so good. Lord, we thank you for just another day of breath, another day of life. Lord, where we can serve you. Lord, in a wonderful day where we can come together as a body of believers who loves you and seeks you, Lord, and we can give you praise and glory, raise our voices in one accord and say, God is great. He is God and there is none like him. For Lord, it is true, you are great. There is none like you. And we seek to glorify and praise you in this time. Amen.
Thank you.
are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet soul. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet soul. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet soul. I will sing again. You ride upon the clouds. You lead me to the truth. You are the Spirit inside me. You ride upon the clouds. You lead me to the truth. You are the Spirit inside me. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet soul. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet soul. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet soul. I will sing again. Oh, sing again. You are sing again.
Jesus who loves me.
Bow down before Him.
Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And bear your cross as you weep for the crown. Tell the world of the new life found. Jesus is calling. Commands all the hosts of heaven. Who else could make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. And what other beauty demands such praises? What other splendor outshines the sun? What other majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. So come and behold him, the one and the only. Sing holy, forever holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Glory consumes like fire. What other power can raise the dead? And what other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. So come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. So come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Thank you.
rescue me from my failing. Who else would offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him Father? Only a holy God. Only a holy God. So come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy forever, a holy God. Come and worship the you and praise you, because you are good and there is none like you. The great God that we call our Father, who loves us, who delivered us from sin. There is none greater than you, Father. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, go ahead and say hi to somebody. It caught me off guard because I was so expecting, even though I've been talking about a week, so expecting, hey, just, you know, kids can be dismissed and then greet one another, and that was going to work. Kids have already been dismissed. They're already over there. So greet one another. Say hi. Smile. Hey, Tom. All right, you'll have to smile, tell them they lost 5 pounds, put a punchline on the end of it, something, wander back. All right. Well, welcome back. I see that we are still intact after a feast. That's good. That's good. Usually takes a little time to come out of the sugar coma just in time for Christmas. Not too many announcements. One that I would mention, obviously, well, you know, we had our first diving headlong into having the kids over there for Children's Church, but on the logistic aspect, just kind of with, you know, we kind of took a step back and went to the services on Saturday night and the two this morning and Sunday evening, just kind of with the way it's going to go. We're going to start with, I just did the Sunday evening for a couple weeks, and we're going to go ahead and pull back on that, which I'm not sad about. if you were planning on occasionally or thinking about if you ever had the opportunity, you were just going to just go to a Sunday evening instead, you better hustle because this will be the last one this evening, and then we'll just absorb them back into what we're doing. In the process of all this, I thank you guys just for your flexibility. I asked for a lot of grace being on this side of it, but if I was on that side of it, I don't know if I would give a lot because it's hard and it's frustrating. But I thank you guys for just bending and flexing with it. And I do expect this will be in the rearview mirror shortly. And we want to be able to, regardless if we always agreed, we want to be able to minister and be the body because this too shall pass and it'll all be done. And then we'll move on. And I'll be excited, just like, you know, I'm excited to get into the book of Nehemiah next year and just looking at the Lord taking us out of this time and beginning to build and to plan and to work the ministry for what he wants to do until he comes. And so I'll be excited about that. But until then, we still have a revelation to finish. I'm going to start with just a little bit of Psalms chapter 2, which is the Messiah's triumph and kingdom, because it speaks into the moment, the chapter that we're going to get into this morning. And beginning in verse 1 of Psalm 2, it says, "Why do the nations rage and the people plot a vain thing," or an empty thing, worthless? "The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, 'Let us break their bonds in pieces and cast away their cords from us.' He who sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision." Of course, then it continues on. Well, we're going to see that in a little more detail today as we get into Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19. And I suppose more since the flood until now, the people and the systems and the rebellion that took place before the flood got its own judgment. But just shortly after the flood, mankind, really kind of under the leadership of its first dictator, Nimrod, decided that they would disobey God, that they would not go and populate the earth. But in fact, they were going to stay where they were. They were going to build a city and make a name for themselves. And they were going to have access to God and to do what they wanted the way that they wanted. And they built an economic system and a religious system and a political system that when God did, in fact, disperse them, a lot of the infection, the disease from that, spread with it into our governments and into our religion, into our economics. And we've talked a lot about that over the last few chapters. Well, today is heaven's victory. We get to see the future before it happens. One, so that we can choose, I think, the blessing of knowing the end of the story, so that we can choose to be on the right side of history. But two, also, that we can rejoice, beginning with today, that one day we're not going to learn war anymore. One day we're not going to look in the history books and say, oh my goodness, there was 100 million people killed last century in communism. This thought that this is the peak of human government. But it only resulted in 100 million people dying. You know, we think we've progressed, and last century was the bloodiest in our known history. You know, we just celebrated Veterans Day on the 11th month and the 11th day and the 11th hour to commemorate and to remember the victory in World War I, the fight against evil. World War II, we still celebrate, and we have pictures of some soldier kissing a nurse because we celebrate the victory against what was occurring in the slaughtering of innocent people for the sake of an ideology. We're going to look at that today, where the culmination of mankind in her governments, all governments, I know that's offensive to us Americans, but all governments that are not the Lord's, all its might, all its strength will be done in a single moment, in a single battle, and the victory is His. The victory is His. And so we want to rejoice that. We talked a little bit about that last week when we talked about the infection that we receive from Babylon into our economic system and how it generates the lust and the desires to cause dissatisfaction with what the Lord has given, and it just produced this unquenchable sin within mankind to where it would pursue all of these things, even down to buying and selling people. Because everything becomes merchandise for what you want, what pleases you. And again, it's not money that is evil, it's the love of it. You know, so anyway, we don't want to go back down that road. It wasn't God gives riches and wealth to some. It's a blessing. But anyway, that was the last chapter, so we're not going to spend a whole lot of time on that. Revelation 19, the final capstone. Religious Babylon was judged in 17. The kings of the earth turned against her. They were done with religion. Got all the goody out of it that they wanted, and then they wiped it out. Economic Babylon, the economic systems of the world, fell in chapter 18. And as we read into the future, what will happen, we see all the might that mankind can muster on the battlefield. The strength of her governments will also meet the same end in this chapter. It is heaven's victory. And you know, everybody has this theory, you know, believers or non-believers, everybody has this, and I'm painting with a broad brush, has this feeling or this understanding that somewhere, somehow, this has all got to come to a head. Things cannot keep progressing as they are. And it manifests itself in different ways, whether they think some comet's going to hit the earth or there's going to be a giant solar flare, or again, you know, if you were old enough, well, I guess, suppose even when I was a kid, caught the end of it. Not that I'm that old. You were preparing for the nuclear holocaust. It was imminent, and you would hide under your desk as if that would help. On through the 60s and the Cuban Missile Crisis and so on and so forth. And then the planet was cooling too fast, and that was going to wreck it all, and there was some acid rain that was going to come, and then there was Y2K and all the crash of all the computers, and that was going to bring about the end, and I don't know. Then the Mayans ran out of space on their calendar, and so that meant the world was going to end in 2012. And now, you know, the oceans are going to rise by a couple feet up to your knees, and that's going to end the world. And I don't know. We run off with all of these different ideas, knowing clearly that things can't continue. And so we have these worst-case scenarios from all these different things, and not to minimize all things that are happening, but we get this exaggerated sense rather than just reading the end of the story. Now, this could be 7 years from now. May it be so. This could be an unknown amount of time in the future, but we are going to read the history before it happens, and we get to rejoice with heaven, that we get to see how it ends. And with any contest, any battle, any sports game or whatever, there's winners and there are losers. And if you were to interview for a, let's say, we'll just say, you know, the NBA championship, the first people you go talk to are the winners. Eventually you'll talk to a good player, or you'll note some noteworthy players from the losers as well, but first you talk to the winners. And in heaven's highlight reels of how it goes down, that's the way this chapter is going to progress just a little bit as well. Chapter 19, beginning in verse 1, after these things, I heard a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication, and he has avenged on her the blood of his servants shed by her. Again they said, Alleluia, her smoke rises up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God who sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Alleluia. Then a voice came from the throne saying, Praise our God, all you his servants, and those who fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters, as the sound of mighty thunderings, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright. For the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. So after these things, I was kind of hoping for a Fusco kid or maybe even a McAfee kid, because I was going to embarrass them, I guess, with a illustration, but I won't. So if you had a basketball player and you were dribbling down the court and you did your perfect jump shot, you picked up your dribble, and, you know, if you know anything about basketball, I guess you'll understand this. If you don't, then I guess be patient. And I said, okay, which one's my pivot foot? And you say, well, I don't know. You haven't actually pivoted yet. But once I stopped and passed the basketball, and I stopped, and I actually did, and I picked up the foot, that would be my pivot foot for as long as I possessed the ball. I couldn't change it. That's where the turning point was. That's where it occurred. You would know that I can't switch it, or that I'd be traveling. I would be breaking the rules. Be setting you up for something that maybe not supposed to happen that way. Well, this word, this phrase here that we begin out in chapter 19, after these things, it becomes a pivot point, if you will, for the book of Revelation. We talked about that in more detail in chapter 4, so I won't beat it to death too much. But when there is this significant change, God wants to direct our attention to something that he is doing and is radically changing permanently. He uses this word. And on this singular day, as we are about to pivot from mankind ruling until Jesus Christ sitting on the throne of David in Jerusalem, the millennium, the thousand-year reign of Christ beginning, this is it. This is the last battle. This is the final day. This is the Daniel chapter 9 at the end of 24, verse 24 through 27, where he says, there are 70 weeks appointed for you and your people. And it's going to bring in the promises. It's going to bring in everlasting righteousness. We're going to seal up prophecy and vision. This is the end of the week. This is the last day of the time period. This is it. And he says, after these things, this is the moment when it's going to pivot. We're going to see the final victory that ushers in a kingdom upon whose ruler it's going to sit on his shoulders, and it's going to have no end. You're not going to learn war anymore. We're not going to have elections anymore. We're never going to experience cancer and colds. And the former things are going to pass away, and God's personally going to put his hand on your face. And if he had a tear, he's going to wipe it away. After all these things are put away. But here's the moment where the score is finally settled. Justice is finally brought. So he puts this little phrase in there that we see periodically to say, hey, let your ears perk up, let your eyes pay attention. There's something going on here. Because the world has been offering you that if you just You can just do it your way. A classic song about that. Obama in his years would have his anthem that would say, yes, we can. Humanism will offer you that it is within you to solve all of mankind's problems. And we stand back and we say, no, the Lord will solve the problems. Yes, he can. That's heaven's answer. That's heaven's answer. And so heaven, as it begins to look at the judgment that is going to wrap it up on all that Babylon is in its systems and its cities, how it is now guilty and fully responsible for the death of those who believed and served the Lord, for the corruption of this world, for the corruption of religion and governments and economics. And heaven says, amen, hallelujah, or truth, so be it. However you want to translate that word, we just generally just say amen, but that's essentially what it means. So be it. Praise Yahweh. Praise the Lord. Praise Jehovah. That's what it is. And that's heaven's response. The smoke is rising forever. She's been judged. She's going down. He says, that's it. It's over. And heaven says, truth. May it be so. Praise God. And then we hear a voice from the throne. And again, I'm going to probably beat on this just a little bit that oftentimes we'll say, you know, we commonly will say, you know, praise the Lord. And it's just oftentimes this exclamation of rejoicing or something that we'll say of our opinion or our heart. But we see in the Psalms that sometimes God or David even instructed people to praise the Lord. That if you know, he would speak to angels, he would speak to people and say, you need to praise the Lord. And I think that is the sense that really comes out of here and what is a sense that often should be understood from hallelujah. And that's all hallelujah is just the Greek version of that Hebrew word. Just brings it across. And I think we're going to find that it's not so much that heaven is just saying and saying rightly so, praise the Lord, but I believe it is also instructing us in this moment and in this judgment to praise the Lord. And perhaps because it's right, I used the illustration this morning, and I guess I will again, you know, in maybe too many sports illustrations for you today. I think it's probably because I haven't actually watched a football game all year, and it's just about to go crazy. It's building up, but anyways. You know, if you had your favorite team, and it was the biggest game ever, and they were going down and maybe you got caught chatting too much and you're talking and they just won the key or they just scored the key touchdown or shot the key three-pointer that's going to seal the game. It's over. And somebody taps you on the shoulder and says, oh, man. Or you see the big thing coming across on the Jumbotron and says, make some noise. You have no problem obeying that. You have no problem getting up on your feet and throwing your hands up. And that's awesome because it's our team. And that's nothing compared to this moment. So right is this judgment. So important. So in the thousands and thousands of years of history and experience, building up to this moment, so great is its magnitude, so horrible is sin, and so wonderful is righteousness that heaven explodes with this thunder, the sound as of many waters, this moment like if you're standing by Niagara Falls and you can't hear each other talking. You can add to the noise, but you can't talk over it. It says it's like a mighty thunder. You're standing right next to a lightning strike and the thunder explodes next to you. This is the praise of heaven over this moment. Amazing. Right and true. And so we hear this voice come from the throne. It says, praise our God. Instructs us. Commands. All you his servants. All those who fear him, both small and great. I don't care who you are or where you're from. This is what you are to properly do. This is the only natural response. And again, I don't think this will be a problem. This won't be like, oh man, I can't believe he's telling me what to do. it'll be, oh yeah, you're right. Hallelujah. An amazing word this is. I appreciate the fact that when, well, a lot of people brought it out, that this is a word that, you know, it may sound slightly different depending on location on the planet and you have a southern draw or where you're at, where you're from, but essentially it never really gets translated into a different language. It is the same everywhere. That's interesting. That what seems to be this highest call of praise, hallelujah or alleluia, that no matter where you go, you can join in on that. No matter where you go. It was interesting listening to a testimony by Damian Kyle. He's a pastor in Modesto, California. And he was talking about getting to go into Romania after communism fell. And for the first time, the churches were going to get to gather like they hadn't got to gather in decades. Without fear. And they were singing that song. There you go. Alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty reigns and just builds. And he said, you know, most of the time I couldn't sing anything. But when you got to that moment, it didn't matter if they were singing in Romania. Everybody could join in on that because it was the same. In heaven, everybody will get to join in on this. Who knows? Maybe that word's even the same in an angelic language. Everybody is saying the same thing. Praise be to God. Alleluia. Because he is the Lord, the ruler of heaven and earth. The word God, the absolute supreme being. Omnipotent. This word that I wish we would just come up with more of a layman's term, because I'm a layman and I appreciate layman's terms. But see, he possesses all power. All that there ever could be or ever will be, ever was. He possesses it and he reigns with it. And we thunder out as the sound of a mighty water and mighty thunderings, alleluia, because this is our God who reigns and he's putting an end to this corrupt world. Praise the Lord. It says, let us, so our response, be glad and rejoice and to give him glory. Now here's one specially for us. And if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, if you're in this room today, because the marriage or for the marriage of the Lamb has come. And we've been talking about that quite a bit this fall with everything going on, the prophecy conference and going through this book of, and I won't go back and hammer too many details, but it's a worthwhile study of just the process and progress of a Jewish marriage and how the father would come to the terms and the agreement and the payment would be paid. And the son would come back to the father's house and he would build onto the father's house a place for him and his bride. And then at a time when only the father knew, when he felt that it was right for the time for the wedding, for them to come together and to be there, he would send the son and the wedding party, and they would go get the bride, and that they would consummate the marriage, and at that point they would truly, more than just legally, be husband and wife. And they would be tucked away for 7 days in this part that was built, especially for her, for them. And they would come out and they would be revealed to the world. The wedding feast would continue. I believe we're at this point where, and again, I think it's some good evidence for why this occurs prior to the tribulation period. Because here, you know, Paul says that we've been espoused, we're the fiancé, we're betrothed to the Lord. And so it just builds on that picture. But here it doesn't use that word anymore. It says his wife. Prior to Jesus physically descending, the church is already no longer betrothed as it was prior, but now his wife. And we're coming out and we will celebrate, we'll be in this mode for 1,000 years with him. And I don't know where I would fall on it, but a lot of your scholarly people who love to have input, they really draw from that and believe that because there was oftentimes this continuation of this special wedding feast after the bride and the groom would come out. That's how they really look at the millennium, our time with Jesus during the 1,000 years, that it is represented as in a wedding feast and a celebration with him. I don't know. I think it's digging a little too hard with the few verses that we have, but I certainly don't have a problem with it because it's going to be a good time. She's made herself ready. We are ready because here we are in this moment, we're looking at ourselves here in the future because of relationship. Because a promise was made, a debt was paid, we believed, we received, and we're there having made ourselves ready by faith. So I make that clear because as per usual, you know, you get 5 people and you get 10 opinions. So why not add another? But people, I find in general, we get a little squeamish about this, especially kind of with the rise and the influence of kind of a lot of really great, I love them, they're brothers in the Lord, but with kind of really the rise of more, I don't know, Reformed theology. So Reformers were great. Not everybody held what's called Reformed theology now. But now they've kind of, it's just what it is. And so everybody gets squeamish about when you talk about our righteous deeds, our righteous acts. But the Lord doesn't. He doesn't have a problem with saying, these things are blessed because they were done in the Lord. He has no problem in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, kind of verse 9 and 10, that when you come before the judgment seat of Christ, that if you have done something good, you are rewarded. He has no problem with that whatsoever. That by the power of the Holy Spirit, as God transforms your life, doing and serving him, doing things in him, that he has no problem calling it good and beautiful and rewarding you for it. And we don't have to instantly retreat back to, well, you know, there's none good and I can't do anything righteous. The fact is, in the Lord, there are things that we can do and God says, good job, I'm going to bless you for it. It doesn't make us anything and it doesn't rob him of his glory. I believe that it magnifies his glory. To use a weak vessel for great things magnifies his glory. To take someone who otherwise cannot do anything and do something through them is just a testimony to him, even if he blesses that vessel or instrument for it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. God, in speaking to this church through Paul, and they were really struggling with some division, that there was envy and strife, and they began to exalt one man over another, one ministry over another, to glorify men. And God doesn't share his glory with a man, with a woman, with a person. It says, who then is Paul and who is Apollos? 1 Corinthians 3:5. But ministers through whom you believed, as the Lord gave to each one. So he says, okay, so you got these people that have impacted your life. You came to Jesus through them. Yeah, that's great. The Lord gave it to them. He says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. And then the logical understanding is, so then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. So to say that God gives us ministry and that he works and that we have a part to play, an accountability and a responsibility, doesn't mean that we're robbing the glory or somehow it's all about us. We're nothing. It's all about God. Verse 8, now he who plants and he who waters are one. We're all a part of the same work. Sometimes we enter a ministry or a harvest that we didn't plant, we didn't have anything to do with. We just help get the blessing. You know, sometimes it's interesting watching people. I think if, like if you had a nice orchard of apples or pears or whatever, and you come in, and they've been growing and doing good for years, and you're like, okay, we want to go in, we want to pick all these apples and pears, we want to maybe make some juice or whatever, we got to press, and go in, and you get a bunch of it, and you make some wonderful juice, and somebody in the group, their first time, they come in, man, I'm an amazing farmer. What are you talking about? 1 year out of this tree's been growing here for 30 years, and you pick a, you know, a couple buckets full, and you think you're a farmer? What? And sometimes we do that. We jump in the ministry, or God gives us something neat to do, and it's a real blessing. And then we think we're something more than we are. It began long before us, and it will continue long after us. We're just a part of one larger work. And it, you know, and God's going to have several reminders in here that we just want to stay a servant. We don't want glory that's not ours. We don't want to be put in a position that God hasn't given. But he does say, now he who plants and he who waters are one, so we're part of the same work. Each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. There are, see, because these good works that Ephesians 2:10 says that God has prepared for us, that we should walk in them because we've been saved by grace. And we weren't just saved to sit, but saved to serve. And serving doesn't end in that moment, but there's blessing and there's things that also come out of that that will stretch into eternity. If they were done in him, if they were built with the proper materials. He says, look, you're going to receive a reward for that which God has entrusted you and empowered you to do. Verse 9, for we are God's fellow workers. And that should blow your mind. If you're teaching Sunday school, if you're helping somebody walk across the street, if you're giving, if you're praying or whatever, that should blow your mind that God has called you and said, hey, not back there, not over there, you are my fellow worker. All right, I'm sure I'm bringing a lot to the game. But that's how good he is, that he would say, hey, I brought you out of the miry clay. I've washed you up. Not just to be there. Why don't you come out and come work with me? I'll even bless you for it. I'll tell you what. I know you live in my house, and I supply everything that you need. And sometimes you don't do nothing. Oh, wait, that's me. No, anyway. I said, you come out, labor with me, and I'll bless you for it. And so as we come to Revelation 19, we're going to see not just blessed, but God is going to take a bunch of knuckleheads like me, somehow that he did something through and with, and he's going to take that and he's going to adorn his bride, not only with the fact that she's there and has been made ready by the righteousness of Jesus, but also made beautiful by what he could do with her, through her, in her. And as you serve the Lord this week, this year, as you intend on serving the Lord in the coming days ahead, no matter where it be, I mean, wherever God has plugged you in, whatever he's called you to be, there's an aspect about that, that if it is done in him, if the Holy Spirit has moved in your life, he's going to set that up as this fine linen to array his bride in. Part of what God has done in his church and in his body in the world is going to be magnified before all creation. And again, it won't be glory to us. It'll be all glory to him. But as in a good wedding, you know, no one would want to take the focus off the bride. And so the Lord really gives a lot of focus to the bride and how she is prepared and the beauty of her. And I appreciate that. And I appreciate the fact that it's been said, and probably well said, that, you know, I've got to travel just a little bit. I've got to see some very beautiful things. And I think it truly was well said that there are very few things in this life, and maybe it's because I'm a dad, I don't know, that are more beautiful than a bride on a wedding day. You know, we look at those moments that really matter. Be it a wedding, be it an important date or a celebration. And we look at these focal points and say, man, praise the Lord. You have been good to us. Verse 9, then he said to me, right blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. That's a fact. You're blessed just by being called. And he said to me, these are true sayings of God. Exclamation point. They're true. And I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, see that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and your of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So John, there's the Lord and there's this massive sound and there's judgment and heaven is just erupting in praise my interpretation, whatever, it just seems that he's so caught up, I've got to worship something, and he turns around to the closest thing. Oops. And I'm actually really thankful for this because sometimes we look at our biggest blunders in life based on how big a moment we committed them in. You know, if nobody's around, nobody's watching, that's no big deal. Trip and fall, try to ninja roll out of it, you're good to go. But if you're walking down the aisle on your wedding day, that's much more embarrassing. Now here's John. You know, he's not out on Patmos on a deserted island, strolling down the beach. He's in heaven, in this amazing worship and celebration. And he turns around and says, oh, I'm going to worship this angel over here. Now that should be a blessing. I mean, it's John. Now, I don't know, you know, I have a few heroes in the scriptures, and John's one of them. And perhaps you could insert a Daniel or a Joseph or an Enoch or a Moses or somebody who just, man, they really just served the Lord wholehearted their whole life. But this is the disciple that Jesus loved, served his whole life and would serve all the way to the end faithfully and amazing. Got to write scripture and to hang out with the Lord. He messed up. And they don't spend a lot of time dwelling on it. Corrects him and moves on. I like that. It's great. Just stop and don't do that. How about let's do something else? This angel probably had a little, I don't know, maybe not, but I would, if it was me, I'd have a little terror in my heart. He probably saw when Lucifer fell and desired worship. This angel didn't desire it, so that's good. He says, look, I'm just a servant. Now, an angel, in our study in Revelation, and if you look across the Old Testament, angels are amazing. We saw one that illuminated the entire planet. They've overthrown armies. There are some that they're just mighty in strength and power. Ezekiel in the beginning, as he would see this one flying around in their circles, and he said, it's awesome. He used that word. It was awe-inspiring. But he said, whoa, that doesn't matter. Don't judge according to what's on the outside. We don't worship anybody but God. We don't worship servants. And that is a wonderful reminder for today. Because we are constantly in search of the well-branded ministry and the rock star preacher and the whatever. We are constantly in search of that one name that we can hold up as an authority, or hey, I follow this or I do this. And there's nothing wrong with God exalting a person or a ministry. He does it. He did it for Moses. He promised that if you humbled yourself, he will exalt you in due time. And when he does it, there's no problem with that. But when we crave it, when we seek to worship it, when we make a servant something more than they are, it doesn't matter if it's human or angelic, we don't worship that. We only worship God. And he says that this testimony that both humans and angels have, it's the spirit of prophecy. Kind of a word salad. The idea, the guts of it, the driving principle behind it is Jesus Christ. You know, if I say, you know, I have a spirit, and we understand that to be something, or there's a spirit being, we understand that to be something. But if I said to you, you know, there's the letter of the law, and then there's the spirit of the law. That word spirit, that understanding, that the spirit of prophecy, that which is its focus, its mindset, what everything is brought to bear, is the testimony of Jesus, who he is, what he has done, the person, nature, and work of Jesus. And that's our litmus test for anything that the Holy Spirit does, because he takes what belongs to Jesus and he distributes it as he wills in the body of Christ to glorify Jesus Christ. And so when we see prophecies or tongues or manifestations of the Holy Spirit or God doing an amazing work, we can always go back and say, does this glorify Jesus? Or does it draw attention somewhere else? Because the spirit of prophecy, the heartbeat of it all, what it is driving towards is the testimony, the person, nature, and work of Jesus, who he is and what he's done. That's what the whole book's about. That's what the angels who are called ministering spirits, that's their purpose. They work in us for things about salvation and they minister to us, but it's still all driving to who Jesus is and what he's done. Our work is about who Jesus is and what he has done. It's the heartbeat of it all. Verse 11, now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. Faithful and True. Now, it's one thing when we have a hope and a promise, but we see here in the future these things fulfilled. We get a glimpse at history in the making, or history completed, and we see the word, the promise, the statement of the fact that he's faithful and true collide with the reality. Because it's definitely, there's something in us that needs not only to understand that a promise is true, but to see it fulfilled brings about a praise in us. Such a praise in us to watch it unfold. We know God is true and we can read his promises, but to watch it unfold in your life, to watch it unfold in the redemption of mankind, or to bring about his kingdom, will bring about a praise that is unparalleled. And he says, man, he is faithful and true. Righteous are his judgments. All right, righteousness he judges and makes war. Moses called God a man of war. The term in the Old Testament, the mighty God, is a description of God's ability to do mightily in battle. And again, I think it's the influence of the humanism in our culture, where sometimes we don't like judgment. We don't like hell. We don't like the finality of God bringing an end to all of these things. And it just kind of creeps in. We're like, oh, I don't know if I like that. And so churches increasingly will talk less and less about the judgment and justice of God and hell. And the fact that there's one day that Jesus Christ is coming and he's going to judge the world in righteousness. That he demands, based on that fact, that everyone should repent today, Acts chapter 17. And now I get the pleasure of talking about his judgment here. And next week we'll talk about hell. And we'll see if anybody comes back after that. Oh. But Jesus Christ wants all that can be redeemed. Our Father in heaven, who is good, after the last harvest, and even past the point of being basically past ripe, pulls the last bit out just a few chapters ago. And when there's nothing left that can be redeemed, in the face of evil, righteousness will act. Jesus Christ, he's not a pacifist. He waits because you and I needed to come to repentance. He waits because there are more who are and will and should be saved. Because he's still at work. But there will be an end to that. When people will no longer receive the love of the truth. When they will no longer listen. And God will act because righteousness in the face of evil has to. Or it's not righteous. And it is a difficult concept. But it is cover to cover in Scripture. His eyes were like a flame of fire. He sees and he judges the thoughts, the intents, goes right through the words to the heart of the matter. His head were many crowns. This is diadems. Speaking of his nature, who he is, ruling in glory and authority. And his robe is dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God, the expression of God, heart, thought, the exact expression. And the armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on a white horse, on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword. With it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God, and he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is the sovereign God. He's the sovereign one. He rules and he reigns. And the world gets to see him in this light, this way for the first time, that the might of their strength that we're going to see is going to come against him. And they'll have the, again, I just love this illustration, they're going to have the strength again against God as a ripe grape against a foot. Well, that's it. You know, because we get caught up with these words, and sometimes people mistakenly, because Satan is described as an adversary to God, that somehow that makes him powerful, or that somehow, maybe even with Jesus, they're somehow equals or something because he's the adversary, right? No, it just means that he's against. I can be an adversary, but it's not a measurement of strength. It's just a matter of position. We're going to look at a battle, and that won't mean that it's really a battle. It just means they're going to come against him, and it's going to go pop. And so that dipped in, you know, it could be something that it is describing a splatter. It could literally be all the way dipped because of the scenario. But he's going to say he's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So let's see how it goes. Verse 17. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in the midst of heaven, come, gather together for the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and of those who sit on them, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, both small and great. No respecter of persons. When judgment comes, when people will not have God, the grace of God, they receive the justice and the judgment, which is exactly what they deserved. It is perfectly righteous. Perfect in righteous. And so God calls in the birds to clean it up because there's going to be a big mess. And I saw the beasts, the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. So there's going to be armies, the Antichrist armies, which will stretch back into the Europe, that revived Roman Empire. We're going to see this massive army, it seems, that very well could be 200 million men coming out of either a confederation of Asian nations or China itself. It boasts those numbers since the 70s. We're going to see armies coming up from parts of Africa. We're going to see armies there from the Middle East. And it seems from previous chapters that these satanic spirits went around to the governments and they basically stirred them all up. We're going to go have it out. And it centers around Jerusalem. And there's a little debate on what specifically they're doing there. They're coming, they think first kind of they're going to have it out with each other. And then they're going to, at one moment, turn. Jesus Christ has come back. And they say, we're going to throw off the bonds of him and his servants. We're going to come against God. And that may seem like that is the pinnacle of insanity, which where sin drives us, brings us. But it seems maybe it's just the logical expression or outworking of people for virtually all of our history, for the satanic powers who have been warring against God for millenniums, that now will try to have it out on the battlefield, the physical battlefield. They've got their shot. Heaven's been opened. God's armies have come down. We're going to take it, they said. Hundreds of millions will gather in what Napoleon described as the greatest battlefield he'd ever seen, natural battlefield, this valley called Megiddo. We call it Armageddon because of Har Megiddo, which is just the mountain of Megiddo that sits right beside it. God calls it the Valley of Decision. It's this 200-mile-long thing up in northern Israel. Jesus is going to come back and he's going to receive his people Israel, it seems, at least in my estimation, somewhere down around the rock city of Petra, Edom, and he's going to come up from the south with his armies. And the armies of the world, all of the technology, all the might, all the power that we could ever muster is going to be turned to come meet Jesus Christ as he walks up here with his people to begin his kingdom. And they're going to make war with him. Verse 20, then the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet who worked signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These guys played a role in bringing judgment and damnation upon perhaps billions. And they're getting a special reward for that. He's going to kill everybody in the army, but he says, those two, I want them. Bring them here. Because we remember that it was to your own peril that you took the mark of the beast, worshipped this Antichrist. And these guys, just like the Pharisees who made their disciples twice the sons of hell that they were, there was payment for that. And so these two, as they deceived the nations, there's a reward coming for them. So they deceived, caused them to worship the image. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. Now we know the lake of fire is prepared for the devil and his angels, but it seems that these two get the first shot at going there. The rest of the army will die. They'll be waiting for the great white throne judgment, which we'll come to, and we're going to find these two are still there. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more in detail, because the rise of, or the resurgence of this idea that the lake of fire is just annihilation, that it is not eternal judgment. And it gets confusing because we throw around the word hell like we throw around the word love. And it's just this blanket that means all these different things, which hell does not. It's just an unfortunate translation that we aren't more specific with our words. Same with love. You can love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and you can love a cheeseburger, but you mean two different things. Hell is really similar. We'll get to that next week. They were cast alive there. The rest were killed with the sword, which proceeds from the mouth of him who sat on the horse. And all the birds were filled with their flesh. They come to take on God, and this isn't a battle. It doesn't even seem that we get any of the mess on us. It's all on the Lord. We're just standing back there like a holy entourage saying, yeah, you go, bro. I'm going to be back here. Hold me back. I'm ready. But he just takes care of it. Thessalonians describes that he will destroy the Antichrist. He will destroy him with the radiant outshining of his glory, of his presence. Here we find out it is his word. In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3, it says that he upholds everything, all things, by the word of his power. You wonder why our world doesn't fall apart, why everything functions the way it does, is because of the word of God. We find in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3, that everything that you see was made from things that you couldn't see, and it was framed by the word of God. And I love stars, because you look at our sun, that's 93 million miles away, and if you were in Phoenix, Arizona, you can cook an egg on your dash off of just this minute fraction of its energy. And that's one in a number that they can't even count that God spoke into existence. And that's just a fraction of the creation. Not even dealing with angels or things that we don't know or the unseen. That's just what we know of. And the armies, all the might of earth says, we're going to go attack him. It'll be a real battle. It doesn't work out. For 200 miles, this valley, up to the horse's bridle, it says the blood is. And again, that could be actually literally flowing. It could just be from the splatter. We don't know, but it's over in an instant. Again, the peak of our technology, the peak of our strength, everything that the world had to bear came and was going to rebel against God. And from Psalm chapter 2, it seems that perhaps it's just a, I don't think so, that God laughs and it's over. Now, if I was building up this story and the scenario for all of human history, that this is going to be a culmination, a great physical victory that brings in my kingdom, I probably would have wrote more. But we don't have much more. That's pretty much it. It's just not a big deal. Moving on. Victory won. Battle over. Praise the Lord. Boom. It's over. So with that, I want to come back to what's emphasized in the first half of the chapter. I almost stopped in the middle of the chapter this time and went through it, but I like to end that way as we'll close with a couple songs rather than one just to praise the Lord this morning. So if you would, turn with me to Psalm chapter 150. I want to end that way because it was, I don't know, maybe I knew it, maybe I didn't. I'd sound smarter if I didn't say that, but but it's fascinating to me that you have what some debate is the most powerful word that we use in praise, hallelujah. And then it's used 26 times in the Bible, 22 times in the Psalms, and only 4 times in the New Testament. All of them in Revelation chapter 19. Nowhere else in the New Testament, when we're crying out, Hosanna or praise God, nowhere else. God reserves this word of praise be to God specifically. That is universally untranslated, understood everywhere, and sets it in Revelation chapter 19 only, as far as the New Testament is concerned. Oh, okay, well, we should end with praise. Psalm 150. The where, the why, the who, or the how and the who of praise. Verse 1. Praise the Lord. Again, I think this is an instruction more than a proclamation. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. That which is set apart. It can be this room. You call it the sanctuary because it's set apart. But it can be anywhere. This is a spot for the Lord. Praise him in his mighty firmament, which is oftentimes looked at as the sky. But literally, interesting these words, is the expanse of his strength. So where? A place that you've designated to worship him and maybe in the expanse of his strength. Anywhere, everywhere. Verse 2, praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. What he has done and who he is. Just praise him according to that. You don't even have to be creative. Just read a verse. Look around you and praise him for his mighty acts and according to his excellent greatness. Verse 3, praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the lute and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments and flutes. Praise him with loud cymbals. Praise him with clashing cymbals. Though with what? Whatever you got. I like to use the example, you got a couple spoons? Man, people have made music with that. Start there. I said pots and pans, and Ben and Mike said, well, just make sure it's not during the worship service. So, yeah, don't bring your pots and pans for time of worship here. But if you're at home, praise him with whatever you got. Now the who of praise. Verse 6, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Everybody. The where, in the expanse of his strength. Wherever you can stop and say, this is where I'm going to praise the Lord. Why? Because he is amazing. And what he has done is amazing. With what? With whatever I got. The who? Do I got breath? Yep. Okay, that's me. I'm going to praise the Lord. Because he is victorious. And there's coming a day, again, where these former things are going to pass away. The weapons of war will be made into something else. The tears that we shed for the loss of loved ones and the pain of this life, God is going to personally, Jesus Christ is going to personally wipe that from your face. Because the battle is going to be won. And we're called to know that today. And to praise him today. Now, it'll be amazing when that promise and reality meet in our experience. But we can begin to praise him today for who he is in the expanse of his strength with whatever we have, with the breath that's been given us today. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this morning, for the reminder that, Lord, everything has an end. And all of the corruption, Lord, so many things that plague our world, they too have an end. As we see the human rights violations that we often call them occurring in Africa and China and so many places around the world, that one day, Lord, in righteousness, you're going to bring those to an end. We see sickness and disease cross our globe, Lord, in many different ways, in many different times, in many different forms. That too is coming to an end. We see injustice plague our world, and that too is coming to an end. So, Lord, as we sing these couple songs, Lord, just as a little bit more time in worship this morning and praise to you, God, we give thanks for that next breath that you told us in Daniel that you hold that in your hand. Lord, we thank you for giving it to us. And now, Lord, we want to give it back to you in praise this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise to the King of Kings.
the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery.
Now and always, thou and thou.
heaven's joys, oh bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, oh ruler of all. So be thou my vision, oh Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that the heart. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my life. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light.
Our Lord, we do need you to be the lamp unto our feet, to guide our path. Lord, there's not a moment where we don't need you to be that. Lord, we are in great need of you, and you are a great God who can fulfill all our needs and more. And we love you and praise you because you are good. There's none like you, and only you have brought us salvation. You are the holy God. Amen.